mention Mike Carballa, who's also one of the co-authors, and Mike couldn't be here, so I want to express that he couldn't make it. And then John Power was also part of the team that did a lot of evaluation as we went along. We're going to talk about the current situation with Pasco County and some history of the project, drivers for alternative biosolids processing, the proposed facility, and then some components of the deal, and then the current project status. Currently, Pasco County produces about 23,000 wet tons a year, waste-activated sludge. From four plants, they've been combining some of their outlier plants, and now they're down to four that they process from. Dewatered cake is ranges from 16% or 84% water. Some is through belt presses, and some is centrifuged by another contractor as well. Their biosolids management and hauling product normally went to either composting facilities, lime stabilization facilities, or landfills. And the ebb and flow of biosolids throughout the state of Florida dictates what that is and where it goes. And unfortunately, some of it had to go as far away as landfills in Georgia during some of the periods of inclement weather and some of the issues we had with RMFs that were just over capacity. A little history of the project. In 2011, Pasco County put out an RFP to solicit for design, build, and operation of new biosolids facilities. There was a company called Earth, Wind, and Fire that was responded, and they were actually awarded the first place on the RFP, and our company was awarded second place. So sometimes a second place trophy is not a bad thing to get. But anyway, the first place company basically dissolved and nothing ever materialized, which then brought our company into play. So Pasco County entered into negotiations with us to comprise the facility. We then went through a very lengthy process with Pasco County and CDM in going through a preliminary design for the construction and the services of the process. A little bit of the drivers behind the goals that were wanted is 62640 was going through some major changes back in the 2011 timeframe. The restrictions that were being proposed were going to be very restrictive to Class B applications, as you can see in the watersheds that are identified through the central part of the state. And so consequently, they were issuing some proposed regulations that were going to give us almost a net zero on phos exchange. So basically, for every pound of phosphorus you brought in the watershed, you had to document that a pound left. And that was really tough to do in a cap. So essentially it was restricted to Class B application to where you just really couldn't do it in those watersheds. Other drivers were things related to local county ordinances. And many of the counties, as you see, 33% of the counties in Florida have ordinances, and another 20 were considering restrictive biosolids ordinances. Many of the other counties, including Pasco, have DEP imposed biosolids land application restrictions due to this sensitive watershed as well. At that particular time, there was a lot of restrictions based off RMFs not having adequate numbers, and landfills were certainly looking at dramatic issues related to biosolids. We've heard many presentations talk about the odor problems related to the biosolids. Some of the landfills were actually completely banning biosolids coming into their facilities. The odor issues were not only creating the problems with the public perception, but also for operators and stuff working in. Biosolids at landfills have a long-term effect with leachate as well, as it was changing some of the life expectancy of those landfill cells. Another driver was the cost. At this particular time, Pasco County had gone through about a 13% cost increase in tip fees based off of the excessive amount of biosolids that was having to be discharged to other sources and the lack of RMFs that were adequately positioned to be able to take product. So the proposed facility, as we came up with some goals related to what we wanted to achieve. First of all, we wanted to achieve no bulking. We wanted to end up with less product than what we started with. And so we started to look at different types of Class A processes that were available, and we kind of settled in on a combination of a couple different processes in a very unique way, and so we have a patent-pending process that we're going to explain a little more about. The system consists of a greenhouse drying pods that will receive and take the initial incoming biosolids that range in that 14 to 18%, depending on whether they're centrifuged or biosol or belt pressed. Then the pasteurization building where the actual pasteurization takes place. Then Tony's gonna speak quite a bit on the odor control system that we initiated. Just to give you a little bit of a layout, these are the two biosolids pods, receiving pods. This is a very early rendering. There's actually receiving buildings on the front side of this. In fact, we may just jump forward to the side site plan, it shows it better. So these are the two greenhouse pods right here. These are receiving buildings that are actually covered so the semis can back up ramps. They'll be able to drop off of a ledge that's 4 feet high into a pitted area that's the same elevation as the greenhouse floors. The payloaders will come in, pick the material up, take it and place it in the greenhouse pods. In the greenhouse pods, these are totally enclosed, Lexan covered greenhouse pods that are clear, so we want as much sunlight as we can to come through. Biosolids are placed at 4 to 6 inches in depth, and then we agitate those biosolids with a machine called Falk, which will keep the flip the dry material and the moist material and keep rotating it around. Essentially what we're trying to do is oxygenate that material right from the get-go, and we oxygenate it off. And that's what the purpose of these greenhouses. This is what is taking the place of your typical dryer facility. So we're essentially trying to take biosolids from as received to about 60% solids in these greenhouses. So we're using the solar to help us to do that so that we don't have to use natural gas for this particular part of the process. Tony will talk about the odor control system in a moment. This material then is conveyed into a process building where the material goes into a day hopper. So two greenhouse units go into the day hopper each morning. And out of the day hopper, the material is conveyed into a pasteurization unit. And essentially what we did is we took belt dryers and stacked the belt dryers so that they can serve a different purpose. This kind of shows the layout inside the greenhouses. What's not shown inside these greenhouses as well is there will be three 18-foot diameter HLVS fans that will be churning the air inside the greenhouse units to help encourage the volatilization and evaporation of the water, in addition to the 200,000 CFMs of air that we're exchanging through the greenhouses on a continuous basis with the odor control system. This again shows the conveyance. We're using conveyors as much as possible because we don't want to crush the material and create more dust. So we load the material on the conveyors in each of the greenhouse pods, goes into the day hopper, feeds into the pasteurization unit, out of the pasteurization unit into a loadout building that will load directly into trucks or can bulk load, bulk store as well. This shows just a little bit about the dryer, and this is just a picture. It's not the final version because what we're doing is very unique. It's a two-belt system. So essentially the biosolids comes into the top belt, 8 foot wide, 28 feet long. There's hot gas that's distributed in amongst that lower belt, the upper belt, and that gas is coming up through biosolids through a porous belt system. The whole purpose of that upper belt is to take the biosolids from as received temperature, ambient temperature, up to an excess of 70 degrees C, which is the definition for pasteurization, 70 degrees C for 30 minutes. So there's one control unit on this entire system. That's what makes it so simple, is the only thing we control is the speed of this upper belt. If we start the material across and we receive temperature here, then we can speed the belt up. If we don't receive temperature, by the time it gets to 75% of its journey, we slow the belt down. The whole goal then, bring it to 70 degrees C. It drops from the top belt to the lower belt where hot gas is blown up through it as well. That lower belt chamber then becomes the pasteurization zone where that biosolid goes on a 30-minute ride and it never changes. It's always 30 minutes and it's held at 70 degrees C or higher for that entire duration, achieving the PFRP for pasteurization. As I mentioned, we come in at 60% solids. The byproduct then of bringing that temperature from ambient to 70 degrees C is we drive off an additional 15 plus points of moisture, which gets us over the 75% solids we need for volatile solids reduction, or for vector attraction reduction. So we achieve vector attractions by achieving 75%, we achieve our pasteurization for our pathogen reduction. So Tony?
So one of the other main goals besides the county producing a class AA biosolids product is being a good neighbor through odor control. And being that the facility wasn't built yet, Merrill Brothers and the county developed multiple pilot units at each of the county's facilities to simulate a scaled version of the greenhouse dryer itself. And then we analyzed air emissions from those pilots so we can better quantify the sulfides, if there were any sulfides, and the odor concentration from those facilities. So here's a snapshot of the pilot unit, basically a scaled down version, laid out the biosolids in a very thin layer. They had ceiling fans and an exhaust fan, sampling from the exhaust fan there. And that exhaust, throughout multiple sampling events, was sent to two different types of laboratories. One was an olfactory type laboratory where they actually have a panel of people who actually sniff and detect odors and what quantity or threshold they're able to detect an odor. And they'll do that, they'll dilute the odor multiple times to determine at what point you dilute it where you can't detect it at all. So that's very valuable data we can plug in a model. The second type of laboratory we sent it to was ALS, who does reduced sulfur compounds or other sulfur compounds per an ASTM method. And what we found was, I'll get into that a little later, but what we found that as soon as the biosolids reached about 30 to 40% dryness, so we kept on measuring odor at different dryness levels, so when it kind of dropped in around 30 to 40%, the odor concentration in both the detection limits and sulfur compounds dramatically dropped. So that'll help feed data in our AirMod model we use to model the odor control system or plant systems. We play with many scenarios for the facility. This diagram shows the windrows. Part of the standard AirMod model is you determine meteorological and wind patterns for the facility. I'll zoom into these a little bit more, but these are the model outputs. So what you do is you basically plug in a certain incoming odor concentration, and then you through analyzing different types of odor control, you figure out how efficient that odor control is. So if you have 100 in and it treats it to 95%, this will model that 5% coming out and tells you what kind of spatial effects it has on the surrounding facilities. So what we were able to model initially was essentially a biofilter system. And you might have saw that in the first rendering Ted showed. A big long biofilter, basically all of the exhaust gas from the greenhouse would be fed into that biofilter, and then that biofilter would treat the air and then release the treated air into the atmosphere. But what we found out is that long biofilter essentially became a low concentration big odor stack. And if you didn't have any heavy wind velocity like the site did, it tended to stay in the area. And you can probably, it reads a little hard to see, but some of these concentrations around the facility here are around 2,000 dilutions per threshold. That means you would have to dilute it about 2,000 times its volume so that only 50 people or 50% of the people would be able to detect the odor. We, for odor control around public facilities, we like to keep that limit around 5. So this was many magnitudes off what we want the odor control to do. So then we looked at, okay, how do we make the biofilter better? So we looked at different types of media to get better odor control out of it, from 50% removal to about 80% removal. But that still kept this overall, it reduced the values, but still created a lot of offsite impacts for odor. Then we looked at a third option with biofilters, and that was covering them completely and then having exhaust stacks at each cell, basically to disperse the off gas from the biofilter vertical into the atmosphere. And what that effect will have is it'll disperse outward, and by the time it reaches the ground again, it'll be dilute enough to where you won't have, or you shouldn't have, as high as the concentration or as nearly high as the concentration as you started with. And that's what this shows right here. So by taking that large biofilter, covering it, and then adding those exhaust stacks, discharging about 3,000 feet per minute, we were able to get the target of about 5 dilutions per threshold contained on the facility site. But I don't know if you all are familiar with the biofilter. You take a huge biofilter and cover it, and then you've got to replace media in 3 to 5 years. There's a good chance the maintenance will fall behind with what's needed, and then it won't be performing as you planned. So again, with this dramatic decrease we saw in the odor concentration with dryness and the relatively weak odors we got from the laboratory. In addition, non-detect on the sulfur compounds, which probably tells us they're there, they're below the detection limit, but it kind of makes us, it kind of opens up our options as far as odor control. And again, this last point is, you know, the key is having that dispersion velocity of 3,000 feet per minute. So what we ended up, to make a system that's more maintainable, where it's easier to replace media, we decided to go with a full carbon system with a dispersion fan to basically boost that incoming velocity 3,000 feet per minute out the exhaust stack. Because it's a low odor concentration, has low H2S, carbon became viable media at that point, to where we felt it wouldn't get spent as quickly as like if you put a carbon unit at Headworks where you're replacing it all the time. So the configuration for bringing an odor at the end of the greenhouse, there's four ports manifolded to feed the carbon unit, and again, that's exhausted up. In this scenario, we had the same odor impacts as I showed on that previous figure, with keeping that projected odor concentration very low and within the facility's site boundaries. So to kind of come back and talk about some key benefits of the project, the facility will produce Class AA fertilizer. It's already registered as a 740 fertilizer with the state of Florida. The product, as you can see in this picture, is relatively dry and uniform. Not a lot of dust. It makes handling very easy. It makes spreading it real easy on land or whatever your outlet is. It's operationally simple. There's some benefits for co-location. The biosolids facility is located on the same campus as Pasco's waste energy facility, which they're able to get an electrical feed at a reduced rate, so they can feed all their biosolids, all their drying fans, exhaust fans, and all any other electrical equipment at a reduced kilowatt per hour fee. It's right next to their biggest wastewater treatment plant, which makes hauling pretty much non-existent. It's pretty much a loop road out, so really reducing the carbon footprint of that operation. Unlike other solar dryers, it gives you the reliability of Class A pathogen destruction through that time and temperature relationship with the dryer. For the county, this is their long-term control plan. They're contracted with Merrill Brothers. There's several performance guarantees. It's fully bonded, and the way the contract is written, it gives them a lot of fail-safes for reliable biosolids treatment in the future. Some components of the deal, I'm gonna go over some of these, but basically they're contracted with Merrill Brothers. They're self-performing some of the work as the DBO. It's a design, build, operate. And then another arm of Merrill Brothers will take over the operation once the facility has gone through performance testing. The guaranteed or not to exceed price for the construction, the design and construction, is $13.5 million. And once it's in, once it's done being constructed, we'll go through a couple months of performance testing, where they'll be rated on processing capacity, quality, odor control requirements, energy consumption, and to make sure they're in compliance with their environmental permits. The initial service agreement is for 15 years with three 5-year renewal options. There's a fixed price for the county, for them to take a ton of the county's material. There's a fixed price that's subject to escalation. For the excess capacity, right now the county's gonna only use about half of the capacity of the facility. So Merrill Brothers is gonna provide the county with basically a host fee for the balance of that capacity, and that's a guaranteed host fee. And then there's also some sharing of the revenue, the profit for selling the product as well. Just real quick, you know, the O&M of the facility falls on Merrill Brothers. They're responsible to operate, maintain the equipment to meet their performance guarantees. And some other standard for DBOs is maintaining their performance bonds, insurances, and that sort of thing. So the project duration is is 24 months, 2 years total. We're somewhere in between the first two. We're about 9 months in, but they've gotten limited notice to proceed on some of the construction. So there's some construction activity going on right now with the greenhouse facility. And right now we're projecting the facility to come online early part of 2018. So project status, here's the facility site here. This is some of the waste energy in the ash landfill cells here. This is taken, I think, about a month ago. Site was cleared, stormwater installed, some of the final grading being done. And here's some recent work showing some of the flat work and reinforcement for the columns to support the greenhouse structure. So with that, I guess we'd open up to any questions.
I have a question. You said it's a patent pending technology. What's the patent on?
Utility patent on a combination of two processes coming together.
How do you know it's not already being applied?
That's why it's pending.
I mean, why would you file for it? Have you defined the high temperature dry effect as being different?
Yes, in the patent pending application, yes we did.
So you stipulated a bulk dry versus a high temperature indirect. I'm just curious because this exists already.
The patent attorneys would have to give you the information on that. I don't have to be able to cite the exact wording in the application.
Okay. Just curious.
Yeah, so it is low temperature. 230 degrees.
Yeah, what did you say, 70 degrees Celsius?
That's the product temperature, yes, the GFRP for faster safety.
Good luck. And how long is a piece of sludge or a piece of biosolids in the greenhouse to get from 60 to 60%? And how does that vary seasonally when, you know, in the wintertime we have less sunlight?
Right. We did a lot of testing on that through open air testing in outdoors, indoors, dark rooms, ventilated. We've done it as quick as 4.5 days and as slow as about 12 to 14. So built redundancy in then on the oversizing of the greenhouses to accommodate for that. And that was part of the moisture analysis. That's why we have to have 200,000 CFM removal of air through each of those greenhouses, is to be able to bring in that lower humidity air or higher humidity air depending on the season. Be able to move enough air to get that moisture out.
So how many days did you design it for?
We were for 12.
Oh, for 12, okay.
Any more questions? Got time for a couple more?
So about the fertilizer, you said you got a fertilizer license to sell and market material. And doesn't the material have to meet certain NPK and microelements? Be a cold fertilizer?
Yes.
So do you put additives into the biosolids and it doesn't meet that? Because my understanding is you take the biosolids from multiple wastewater treatment plants. How do you make sure that it still meets that minimum requirement?
We took a combination of seven different facilities that we haul for that would be coming into this, and we ran them each individually through all the nutrient analysis, and then we did a volumetric blending and then rate blending depending on the size of the facility. And that's how we came up with the nutrient analysis with the fertilizer license.
So you apply it once and you get the license and then you don't have to retest again like you would have to do with the plants that
what would?
Homogenize the material. I mean, one day you'll have 18% going in, the other day you'll have 25%. You said sometimes belt will compress, sometimes centrifuge that have different water content.
The greenhouse will control what comes into the pasteurization unit, because we won't take it out of the greenhouse until it achieves 60 to 65%. So we come in with a consistent percent solids into the pasteurization unit. So the variability happens in the greenhouse, where it may take longer to get to 60 or 65 versus making the dryer have to adjust a lot.
So do you measure before it goes into pasteurization? Because it isoconveyors, so it means you push it all back into the conveyor, and the conveyor takes it to the dump?
We'll scoop it. Yeah, we'll scoop it up, put it into a loaded buggy, a buggy that will feed the feed conveyor that takes it to the center section and then up into the day hopper. And so we'll test those cells, so we'll know, you know, if we test them in advance, so we know what percent solids they're achieving prior to each day. But there again, the variability of being able to slow the upper belt on the belt dryer down allows us to be able to accommodate a little wider range of percent solids coming in.
What's your wet tunnel throughput? You may have mentioned it out here. What's your annual wet tunnel throughput, and what's the footprint of the solar dryer?
50,000 wet tons a year is what our throughput would be. The solar dryer is 130,000 square feet for the two greenhouse units combined.
To add to some of the greenhouse conversation, there are performance guarantees in place where they're only allowed to bring in 16% total solids or higher. Solids concentration sludge in it. It has to be waste activated or aerobically digested, and we eliminated some other types of processed sludge for odor concerns and other reasons.
Tony, just real quickly, did you look at the sort of the biofilters in a can as opposed to one biofilter versus the carbon?
We didn't look into, well, it was kind of the package. When we initially looked at biofilters, the traditional 4-foot mulch, different type of wood chips, and about 50% removal efficiency is what we expected. Then we looked into what I guess would replicate a package unit to something with about 10-foot deep of media, lava rock, different types of harder media, and then covering that with the exhaust stacks.
Probably ran the issues there was the CFM requirements. It was going to be really tough to have a single unit, so we had to do the multiples.
So you run 200,000 CFM for each of your canisters?
28,000, yeah.
28,005 through each one, and there's 14 of them.
Oh. How do you bring the biosolids into the chambers, and what is it agitated with? You mentioned that it gets flipped around.
It's a machine called a Falk. It's like a tiller on the back of a tractor. It's like almost like a rotor tiller type thing. It's got skid pads so it can scrape the floor and agitate it mechanically that way.
So the tractor drives over the sludge.
Yes.
While it does that.
Yes.
It's like a brown beer, but a little finer agitation and more controlled stacking.
Right. We want to be able to get through a greenhouse in 15 minutes, and so we need to be able to move pretty good to get through. It'll be placed with many payloaders. They'll scoop the material out of that pitted area, scoop it, bring it in, place it, and then the fall will